गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुरेव परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै नैव वाचा न मनसा प्राप्तुं शक्यो न चक्षुषा अस्तीति ब्रूते यत्र कथं तदुपलभ्यते द सेल्फ कैनॉट बी रीच्ड बाय स्पीच नॉर बाय माइंड एंड नॉर इवन बाय द आई हाउ कैन इट बी रियलाइज्ड अदरवाइज देन फ्रॉम दोज हु से दैट इट एग्जिस्ट्स दिस इज समथिंग फनी बिकॉज we are searching for that for which there is no proof other than our own experience. That's the only proof. But till we do not get to it, how do we know that it is? And there we have, so that point is being told because all the sources of knowledge for us are either through words or through ideations and thoughts or through the senses. But all these three faculties do not function in that realm. Then how do we come to know? It is through two ways. Either we accept, not either, we accept the words of the scriptures as a truth and we go and meet the realized masters who have come to realize what the scriptures are saying. These are the only praman. Praman means this is the only proof that you can get. Because among the world, within the world, you will never find any proof of the reality of a person who has known the reality in your daily meetings. So you have to go to such a person, the one who has realized and who is able to teach you also at the same time. So here it is told that just as a driver in a car cannot be rolled over upon by a car. Why? Because he is inside the car. The car cannot go over him. Isn't it? Same way. Exactly the same way. This infinite reality, the Atman, they cannot come to know as long as they are driving in the car of the senses, the mind and the intellect. And until and unless all these functionings are not, even though they turn upon, because the only tool that you have is the senses, the mind and the intellect with which you gain knowledge. But senses are incapable, the mind is incapable and the intellect is also incapable of ever coming to know it. So how do you come to know? You come to the scriptures and you come to the masters who are experiencing it while living. That's the only way. And apart from that, if you can, and only by coming to them and by studying the scriptures, you will come to know that this reality, it exists. It does not, there is nothing called non-existence, a reality. How can you have non-existent reality? It is existent reality. It is a solid reality. It is.
So, isn't there an intuition also in the sense in each person that there is something? And that's what we're saying for all the time?
Yeah, but that intuition we already talked about, that it is when you synchronize your faculties to search for the truth. Then that's when the intuition comes. But the doubt always remains. Doubt all. So now you have heard it, you have read it. So maybe you don't have a doubt. Majority of the people have a doubt. That's why they don't go after it. So we are not talking about the seeker, but seeker also on the path can many times get distracted. And that distraction is because he is wanting an objective experience of reality. And sometimes when he reaches the state beyond total mind, it can be, array, there is nothing there. I have wasted my time controlling everything. It is not a reality which is non-existent. It is a solid existent reality. And that you are, recognize that. And once having recognized, you be that. And you live that. So it is not an imagination in your mind that there is something called reality and by knowing it, we will become realized. No, it is not an imagination. It is the closer than the closest. It's near, nearer than the nearest. Discover it. And that inspiration we get from the scriptures, the technology we get from the scriptures, and those who have practiced that technology and realized that reality, we see that in the masters who are still living today. Many, many, many of them. But compared to the 7-8 billion population, there will be only a few handful. So in this way, we must seek. We began with the beginning. We must seek a master who knows. That's why Nachiketa has gone to the Lord of Death. He knows that he knows. So he asks. And then once having heard, we must have faith and courage and confidence within ourselves to realize the goal that is set in front of us by the scriptures and also by ourselves. By the scriptures, by saying that it is the reality, by masters having realized that reality, and by us, by wanting that reality. Then alone we will reach there. And we have the proof in front. The scriptures are also talking about it, and there are masters who have realized it also. And why do I want it? Because I want to be free of all this bondage and misery and argumentation and this whatnot, continuously running after the world. But when I say this, thought is coming to me that it is not because you are running away from the world that you want the reality. You want the reality because man is continuously seeking perfection in his life. Continuously is wanting to be more and more and more. So that is the reason that I want to become the one with the reality. Not because I want to run away from the world. You can run away from the world as a suicide also. We don't want to commit suicide by running away. No, we are inspired by the reality. Therefore, we want to know the reality. And that, for that inspiration, when that inspiration is there, then automatically within you, dispassion for the world will come. And that dispassion is not depression. That dispassion is out of understanding and knowledge that nothing in this world can ever give me that happiness that the knowledge of the self can give me. Astityevopalabdhavyah tattva bhavena chobhayoho Astityevopalabdhasya tattva bhava prasidati. The self is first to be realized as existing and then as it really is. Of these aspects, the real nature of the self that has been known as merely existing becomes evident to the seeker. This atma, this self can be realized by us either as conditioned reality or as unconditioned reality, without any attributes, without any qualities, or with qualities. What is with qualities? The God that every religion has, which we talked about as total mind. So it can be recognized as the total, expressing through the total mind, or it can be realized as without any attributes. And so you have a choice. You go after any one of them. but we'll talk about it more. And when you do not choose it with attributes, with total manifestation, then it expresses itself as the pure witness within all states of our experiences or all states of our consciousness. And this way Nachiketa has been pointed out, Nachiketa has been given the indication that recognize it to be existing. It is not an inert, it is not a non-existence, because when we come to the void, if we are bypassing the total mind, the void that we come across, there this feeling can come that it is nothing, and then you come back. Then what do? So, as a warning. So here the teacher is saying, I have already given you the support, the Om. And we were told that when you chant Om, you can gain the highest of the highest heavens, which is the total mind. And you, or if you choose while contemplating on Om to know the witness, then you will come to know the witness. If you choose to know the God, you will come to know the God. These people are chanting Om Bhurgo Swadat Savitarvayanam. If you chant Om with that mantra, it is making you remember the Lord Sun, that He is the all-shining principle. Then you will gain the abode of the sun. You will be bright and shining, but you will not be realized. Wherever your thought, whatever your intention is, that alone will be realized. So, the thought says that the self is first to be realized as existing and then as it really is. Of these, the real nature of the self that has to be known as merely existing becomes evident to the seeker. Existing means that it is. It is not. And either our Adi Shankaracharya, whose commentary we are following, he says in his commentary that the path to the total heaven, the infinite heaven, the God, what we call as God principle or the God mind, the total mind, that path is strewn with lot of difficulties, with lot of challenges, with lot of potholes, where, you know, it's a very rough ride to get there. As I said before, lot of merit is required to get there, and lot of energy is expended. And he says, why you want to go there and then wait for realization to happen? Instead, you choose, put all your efforts and come to be the witness. And once you are the witness, that's it. So he says, don't go in that other way. You go only to the witness. And this way, the meditator is being asked by the Lord of Death, meditator, the Nachiketa, the student, that concentrate, meditate, contemplate on the truth as existence and not as not existence. And this way, he who comes to recognize that this self that which is within me, this life principle that is within me, this witness that is within me, who is knowing everything, the entire creation of the names and forms, the entire being, as I, the person of body, breath, mind, intellect, who is knowing the everything as, and eventually coming to recognize that this witness is existing. This witness is not non-existence. The reason non-existence thought can come up, because thoughts cannot reach there, you see. So if thoughts cannot reach there, then what?
What verse are we on?
We are on 13. So this way, he who realizes the essence, the core within himself as existing, he alone comes to know that this existence is the truth. Existence is not a thing to be known from outside. Existence, I am. This is the conclusion that he comes to, and it is a it is a subjective experience, it is not an objective experience. In this way, the pure state of being, kevala astitva bhava, kevala, the one alone, astitva, my innermost personality or core, bhava, the feeling, but there is no mind to feel, is declared by the Upanishads as the self-realization moment, or the moment when you are face to face, or the moment where in the previous verse it was told, you are, it's like you are facing yourself, looking at yourself in the mirror, like that is that moment. And in this manner, the God is telling Nachiketa, you can do it, you can get there and recognize it in this manner. A person who recognizes himself, his innermost self in this manner, is a living God-man on earth. There is no gaining in this process. You don't gain anything when you realize. Why? You're already it. In fact, you will lose in the process. What you will lose? What is that?
Relative.
Huh? Relative. Everything relative will be lost. And once you realize yourself, it is a gainless gain. It's a contradictory, it's a gainless gain. It's an experienceless experience. It's a knowingless knowing. And in that state of being, there is the only experience that I alone am. And this thought that I alone am is also without any thought erupting in your mind.
When you come back from that, is there just the feeling of I?
You cannot come back from that.
Mm-hmm.
Once you know it, you are gone.
Trying to put something that can't be explained.
Once you experience it, or once you experience yourself as that core, there is no question of coming back. Just like, again, be very careful. This is where our intellect tries to remain in charge, because it doesn't want to leave the variety. It's afraid. Just like when we wake up from the dream, we never go back into the dream state. We never try to repeat the dream experience. Exactly the same way, when we come to realize our own essential nature, we will never experience the world as we are experiencing as an individual. Now say.
I was just thinking of Moses and the burning bush. When Moses asked the burning bush, which was supposed to be God, what should he tell the people who he was? And
now, when you see masters behaving, there are many masters. Jesus was a master. Moses was. So many of them are there. Okay? Sai Baba is. Ammachi is. What you see them functioning as a body, they don't experience themselves as functioning as a body. This is the difference.
The burning bush should go back and tell them that I am what I am.
Ah.
That's wrong.
Okay, yeah, some words will have to be used. That's what the scriptures are saying, that I am what I am. So many times in other Upanishads it has come. Once you come to know yourself, whatever in that moment of realization comes out, it will be like that only. Experienceless experience. You try to, what happened? You look very happy. He'll just walk away. He's not going to answer your questions. No, tell me. You just sit silent. This is what Ramana Maharishi used to do. He used to sit silent. What can he tell? So at that time, when a master is functioning, a realized master is functioning in this world, there is no individual functioning through him. It is the totality which is functioning through him. He becomes a witness of everything that is going on, or he experiences everything as I. This is all we can say. Even scriptures say that okay, we can put to your mind, inquiring mind, how a realized master lives, we can tell you this much. But more than this we cannot, because even we are not qualified to describe how a realized master functions in the world. They cannot say that. So, important point here is, I just digressed a little bit, important point is, you have to recognize that reality as existing, and when you gain that, become one with that existing reality, the self within, there is no gain. It's a gainless gain. It is an experienceless experience. It is a knowingless knowing. This is what is the teacher trying to communicate to the student. Then in the 14th verse, yada sarve pramuchyante kamayesya hrudishritaha adhamartyo amrito bhavati atra brahma samushnate. When all the desires that dwell in the heart are destroyed, then the mortal becomes immortal and he attains Brahman, that is pure consciousness or reality, even here while living. So reality, according to certain religions, realization is only possible, sainthood is only possible after posthumously. Like, you know, certain, when someone has passed away on a battlefield, then they give some medals are there. I don't know which ones, but some of them are there. They say, oh, what a fantastic. While he was doing, they didn't even appreciate that fellow. After dying, they are giving all this. That we are politicians, you know, that we are doing something. We are recognizing. But you die for our sake, because our ideologies, they don't want to go there, but they will send. Same way, some pontiffs, they declare saints posthumously. When you prove that there was a miracle, when you prove that something has happened, now he or she is qualified for sainthood. No, we don't accept that. It is possible to be a sage or a saint even while living. There are enough examples in this on this planet even today, in every part of the world. And that is being told here, that the mortal becomes immortal when he realizes himself in the manner that has been shown and has got no doubts whatsoever. He is abiding in that. And how will abidance come? When all the desires that dwell in his heart are destroyed. And the only way all the desires can be destroyed in toto is only when he comes to abide in himself. That is the only time. Otherwise, the last desire that I want to know myself, it will be still there. Still enough crease on consciousness which needs to be ironed out. And that ironing out will happen only by surrendering that that last desire. So this way, such people, the Advaitins, the Vedantins, the thought is that there is only one without a second reality. There is no two, there is only one. The only reason we are seeing the manyness, we are seeing the variety, is only because of our defective vision. That's all. Just like when we look at the moon, and if you touch the eye, suddenly the two moons start appearing in the sky. Are there two moons? No. You're having a defective vision. Same way, if I take this out, I can't see your eyes. I see only black holes everywhere. Ready to create another creation. Black holes. The moment I wear, the vision gets corrected. Similarly, what vision we have is a egocentric vision, which promotes, which qualifies, which takes this variety to be real. And when we rediscover our own identity as that one without a second reality, we find, array, everything I am. In spite of the variety, we discover the unity in diversity. And that's the final perfection, or the final rung in the ladder of evolution of man. There's nothing else beyond that. And in this way, such people who realize this while living, they are called Jivan Muktas, and those people who are convinced of it and some little bit dirt is still to be removed and that makes them, and they die with the thought of this reality when the last breath leaves, they are called Videha Mukta. And in this way, in the 15th verse, Yada sarve prabhidyante hridayasyeha granthayaha adhamartyo amrito bhavati etavadanushasanam anushasanam. This much alone is the instruction of all Upanishads. Now we are coming to the conclusion of the Upanishad. This is what the Upanishad has to say, and other Upanishads have to say, that the one who comes to know himself as that Atman, as that infinite self, he becomes a living God-man even while he's in the body. This is all Upanishads have to say. What else? They have to say that when all the knots of the heart are destroyed, yada sarve prabhidyante hridayasya granthaya, hridaya granthi, this is in other Upanishads also it has come, hridaya granthi, the knot of the heart. Hridaya means heart, granthi means the knot, and it's a very funny knot. I have told you before also what this knot is made up of. It is made up of ignorance, desire and action. Ignorance is the cause, desire and action are the effect. Cause, there are three roots. Every effect must have a cause. Cause itself appears as many effects, and if you remove the cause, there is no effect. If this rule is, three rules are remembered. The first rule, every effect must have a cause. So, we are doing actions, we have desires, there must be a cause. What is that cause? Ignorance. If you remove ignorance, then will desires and action remain? So how do you remove ignorance? By realizing, once you know your identity, ignorance is gone. And if ignorance is gone, along with it, whatever little bit of desire is there, that will also go away. And desire is the motivating force for you to act in life. Otherwise, there is no action necessary. So in this way, the teacher is saying that when all the knots of the heart, these three, avidya, kama, karma, ignorance, desire and action, when these, and this knot is also funny, it is like this. If you take this cloth and if you tie this, how? Is this a knot? Very strong knot. It's a sailor's knot, one of the knots that they use, and it's very strong, everything is, but the beauty is, the material is the same cloth, the knot is made out of the same cloth, but if you pull, if you just pull in one direction, one thing, where is it? I made it too tight, I think. It doesn't matter. What is? What can I do? So, wait. It will come. So, if... If I have a thread, I'll show you afterwards, or a rope. It's not coming with this because it's all that if you just pull it, it opens up. See, at that time I made it too tight. With the rope, even if you make it tight, if you pull it, it opens up. So, was there a knot, or was it an imagined knot? There was a knot. But the material was always the cloth. In that cloth, the knot has as if appeared because of the twisting and turning of the cloth. In the cloth, which is normally plain, when you do it, the crease appears. But is a crease something other than the cloth? No. Similarly, a person who is seeking the Atman, the self within, the knots of the heart are destroyed while living. He who has destroyed it, such a person comes to become an immortal, living immortal in this world. And in this way, jnane naiva tu kaivalam, to such a ignorance can be only ended with knowledge, and the knowledge, liberation comes only with knowledge. So you cannot say, I'm going to know the world also and I want to be liberated also. It cannot be possible. Because the cause of the world is ignorance. Maya, another word is Maya. And it's so enchanting. She's a temptress. Lures you from anywhere. When you are at your you are comfortable, suddenly she will come and take you for a ride. So the only way you can checkmate that temptress, that ignorance, is by knowledge. Because nature is a woman in any language, not in this language. Even in your language also, nature is female in nature, and it's continuously changing. It's continuously all the, what you call, the nature is always putting out the best in order to attract your senses, and that's what it is. So, for this purpose, the teacher has again made another point, that this is the instruction, this is the last instruction that of the Upanishads, that once one comes to know himself, the knots of the heart that was keeping him in this embodied existence, that is destroyed once and for all. Shatam chaika cha hridayasya nad. Different tune. Shatam chaika cha hridayasya nadyaha tasam murdhanam abhini srutaika tayordhva mayan amrutatvameti vishvadanya utkramane bhavanti. Here it says, 101 are the nerves of the heart. Of them one, Sushumna, penetrates the crown of the head. Going upwards through that nerve, one attains immortality. The others departed live differently. So here what is being told is not the, remember many times the word Amritatvam has come, meaning immortality has come. And in those moments that it has come in the previous verses, we have considered it as relative immortality. Meaning you have reached the total mind, and that is also relatively immortal till the end of time. So here they are talking about that if you find this abstract reality difficult to contemplate upon, then you can contemplate on that heart of yours. And where is the cave of the heart? That we have already told. When you contemplate, there are 101 nerves which nourish that entire being that you are. And out of all those 101 nerves which nourish you, there is one nerve which begins from the base of your spine and goes all the way to the top. And all the other branches, all the other nerves are in some way or the other connected to this main trunk which is in your spine. Even in modern science, all the if you see the nerve picture, from the spine everything is going out into the arms, legs, stomach, everywhere. And it goes into the apex here, and from there the single nerves comes up to the point where the small children do not have the bone. And that is the crown. And this way, a person who is contemplating on that energy, it's a hard one. If you want to go through all the experiences, you bring the energy, invoke the energy from the space and bring it again and again to the top of your crown. Such a person attains immortality. He comes to the Brahma Loka. He comes to the abode of the Creator and stays there till the end of time, and that is the immortality that is being told. But our Adi Shankaracharya, he says, no, we do not want to go in that manner. We go direct way. Why create more hassles for our journey? But it's also said that na utkramante, meaning where is that? Vishwadanya Vishwam Danya Utkramane Bhavanti, meaning na tasya prana utkramanti, meaning such a person who has reached that abode of the Creator, for such a person there is no other journey thereafter. He, by knowing the reality, he becomes the reality, and this is the final destination, the Kaivalya, the one that he was seeking, or he has reached, we are seeking, we will hopefully reach within this lifetime. In the 17th verse, it is told that Angushta Matra Purushontaratma Sada Jananam Hrudaye Sannivishtaha Tam Swat Sharirat Pravruheta Sunja Munjadi Munjadi Veshikam Dhairyena Tam Vidya Chukram Amrutam Tam Vidya Chukram Amrutamiti. Whenever the word iti comes, understand, it's the end of the text, or it's the end of the chapter, or it's end of the thought that is being presented. So here the last word is coming, amrutam iti, this is the immortality. What is that? The one, angushta matra purushontaratma sada jananam hrudaye sannivishta, the one who, as we have mentioned before, is able to contemplate on the inner self as that thumb-sized space, in the thumb-sized space within his heart, and invoke that the self in there. Such a person, here it's written, one should draw him out from one's own body with a steadiness as one draws the pith, the central stalk, from a reed. Know him as pure and immortal. Yes, know him as the pure and immortal. So you have to draw him out. He is always there. You have to draw out the strength in your muscles by going to the gym. You have to draw out your abilities by making a child go to the school and recognize that he has more potential than just playing. So whatever field you put your mind to, put your attention, your mind to, that you become deft in that. Similarly, if you put, you should put your attention on that Paramatma, on that reality within yourself, in the heart space, and there, that heart space is about the size of a thumb, not about, is the size of a thumb, and in that you draw. How? You don't, you force, no, it just like the pith of a reed is taken out. The reed is a very delicate plant, and from the skin you have to take out the pith. So it requires a lot of care, it requires a lot of gentleness, no unnecessary force, otherwise it will break, otherwise you will get the, you will not be able to take out anything from it. And therefore, how careful you have to be in taking out that pith from the reed, even more careful, more gentle, more subtle, more lovingly, more carefully, all those type of words you have to have, that feeling you have to have in order to draw out this inner core that the self is. And because if you are forcing, then the rajas is there, then the INS is there, that will become an impediment. If too much softness is there, then nothing will come out. if let it come out by itself, then it will never come out. So you have to employ all the different tricks of how to bring it out. Different tricks, but gentle. It's not possible by mere force. When you come to recognize it, know him as pure and immortal. Know that it is pure. That is the reality. Then don't doubt it. And again, that has been reinforced. Know him as the pure, the most pure. Again, so two times, meaning that is the uncaused cause, that is the final abode, that is the ultimate reality. And this prop has been given to us as the thumb-sized space in the heart only at the beginning stages. We need some prop, otherwise you cannot contemplate on the abstract. Very difficult. Looking into the space, doing what? So it helps you to your mind to get concentrated. And eventually that is also dropped. But once you know that I am, not separate to him, that I am. And in this way, for such a person who has come to realize himself, there are no negativities, there are no lower emotions, no lust, no anger, jealousy, greed, hypocrisy, envy, ego, all of them vanish in toto. And for such a person comes to realize himself. And the teacher is telling the student that he has given all these instructions. This is the last one now. It's not an instruction, it's a reminder. And now he's saying, Mrityu proktam nachiketo thala. Mrityu proktam nachiketo thalabdhva vidyametam yoga vidhim chakrutsnam brahma prapto virajo bhudam vimrityu anyopyevam yo vidhyatma meva iti kathakopanishadi dvitiyadhyaye shashti valli. Nachiketa, having been so instructed by Lord Death in this knowledge and in the whole process of yoga, became free from all impurities and death and attained Brahman, and so will attain any other too who knows thus the inner self. So it is not just an imaginary story with an imaginary person. Yes, it may be. Some people may take it to be. But the instructions given there are as potent then and as potent now. If one follows this methodology and takes any one contemplation and sits with it and recognizes that truth within themselves, they, even you all who are listening to it, can come to know. So what is to be done now? After that, Nachiketa listened to this last message from the teacher. He went into a place of solitude and then started contemplating on that reality in his heart, and eventually came to realize it, because he continued. He didn't pass away there. He was only 9 years old. He's got a life to live, but he realized it, and so can you. So it is not that only some special selected people are. No, anyone who decides that I want reality to the exclusion of everything else and who contemplates in this manner will come to know that, even while living. So it is within your grasp, but choice you have to make. And in this way, the Kathopanishad conclude, this is the sadhana that is given, and here it is called, what? Brahma prapto virojo bhut vimrityuhu. Having gained the self, having gained the Brahman, having gained the reality, such a person, virojo bhut vimrityuhu, becomes free of death, becomes free of impurities, becomes free of virtue and vice, becomes free of past and future, becomes free of cause and effect. He recognizes himself as himself. And in this way, the sadhana that was given to us, we have already seen before, and that is in the jnana sadhana, in the path of knowledge. This is the path of knowledge, where you change the conviction and your experience changes. That's all. You don't have to change the environment to change the conviction. No, you change the conviction. It's not what seeing is believing is not the reality. Believing is seeing. We change it that way. Take charge, take control, and make a choice that I choose to be the infinite reality, and for that, control the sense organs, control the mind, control the intellect, and go through the discipline. And when the slowly, no force should be applied, enjoy the whole process, and slowly the mind will start sublimating. And as the mind starts sublimating in slowly various stages, eventually concentration is achieved. That concentration is to be applied single pointedly without any break to the innermost core of your heart, and eventually realize the self within. And once he attains the inner self, he is the inner self. And the self and the one who wants to know the self are no two separate entities. They become one and become one whole. And this way, Nachiketa realized himself, and the teacher is saying, so can you all, O friends. Om, repeat after me. Om Sahana Vavatu.
Om
Sahana Vavatu. Sahanau Bhunaktu. Sahaviryam.
Sahaviryam.
Karavavahai. Tejasvinava.
Dhitamastu.
Mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
With this we conclude the Kathopanishad discussion, and the mantra says, let him protect, that may that reality protect us both, who is both the teacher and the student. May he bless us with bliss of knowledge, who us the teacher and the student. May he bless the student with the knowledge, may he bless the teacher also with the knowledge, so that he is able to explain properly and we are able to apprehend that teaching properly. Let us exert together. May the teacher put efforts in explaining in a manner that is conducive to our understanding, and may we also prepare ourselves more than the teacher in order to grasp that cannot be grasped through the words, because all he can use is the words, and all you have the faculty is that of the intellect. So may my intellect become sharp, single pointed, purified, so that I am able to intuit that which is being indicated through the words of the teacher. And this way, may what we study be well studied, that is self-explanatory, we explained it before, and may we not hate, quarrel with each other, meaning may we not misunderstand each other, may we not quarrel with each other, may we not fight with each other, may we not kill each other. There are many cases, where it happens. So, and here when they say the teacher is the teacher within. So trust him, have faith. The inner voice is continuously guiding you. Don't overlook it. Don't say, I'm going to do it my way. And then suffer. Only suffering will come. Listen to that voice. Listen to that inner voice. And do not quarrel with it. Trust. Make friendship. And in this way, the teacher can only communicate. But each one has to realize themselves. And this way, Hari Om Tat Sat Om Purnamadam Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah Hari Om. Just sit quietly for some time.